Okay, good morning everyone and welcome to the 31st meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We've got apologies from Colette Stevenson, our convener this morning, and we now move on to agenda item one, decision in taking business in private. Are we agreed to take agenda item four in private, members?
Yes.
Well, agreed, thank you. Agenda item two, the Scottish Employment Injuries Advisory Council Bill, which is we're having the session. This is a member's bill which has been introduced by Mark Griffin, MSP, on 8th of June 2023, and it is currently undergoing stage one scrutiny. We've already heard from four panels, and we'll hear from Mark Griffin, the member in charge of the bill, next week. But this morning, I welcome Sherlyn Somerville, Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Kirsten Simonette-Lefevre, Solicitor, and Nariska Summers, Policy Manager, Scottish Government. You're all very welcome. Thank you for joining us this morning to aid our scrutiny. And Cabinet Secretary, I believe you've got a short opening statement before we move to questions.
Thank you very much and good morning, Convener. And I very much welcome the opportunity to contribute to your evidence sessions on Mark Griffin's Scottish Employment Injuries Advisory Council Bill. The committee will be aware that the Scottish Government intends to oppose this bill, as we are committed to undertaking a wider range public consultation on our approach to replacing the UK-wide industrial injury scheme with employment injury assistance. The results of that consultation will have a major impact on the Scottish Government's views on whether to replicate the UK Industrial Injuries Advisory Council in Scotland. And if there is a decision to replicate, only then can we, of course, then look at what that body would look like. As the committee will know, the Industrial Injuries Disablement Scheme is currently being delivered by the Department of Work and Pensions under agency agreement, which runs to March 2026. The committee will also be aware that there are particular complexities associated with replacing the scheme. It was introduced in 1948 and is delivered almost entirely using a paper-based system. Over 100,000 paper files relating to Scottish awards are currently held in a number of warehouses. This contrasts starkly with the largely digital systems associated with the benefits that have been devolved to date. It is therefore vital that we continue to work closely with the UK Government to work through these challenges in a way that protects the interests of current clients. While this considerably constrains our ability to make fundamental changes in the short term, I am committed to considering how employment injury assistance can best meet the needs of the people of Scotland who are protecting payments to current clients, which is, as always, our utmost priority. Mr Griffin's bill would introduce a Scottish Advisory Council without employment injury assistance being in place. Until Social Security Scotland is delivering employment injury assistance, we would not be able to make any legislative or operational changes in response to any recommendations made by this proposed council. The only way of making changes now would be to renegotiate the agency agreement, which would potentially put clients' existing payments at risk. It is therefore my view that it is not logical to introduce a statutory advisory council before our policy approach has been settled, both in terms of policy development and in terms of the best use of resources and value for money. That being said, I very much recognise the arguments for establishing a Scottish equivalent to the Industrial Injuries Advisory Council made by Mr Griffin and some stakeholders. I'm also aware that many people would like changes to be made through employment injury assistance, including to modernise the scheme. Responses to our 2016 consultation demonstrate the wide range of views people have about the current scheme, including those who want to see aspects of it maintained. The committee have heard many of these views from stakeholders in the course of its scrutiny of the bill, but it is important to clarify that this bill does not make changes to the criteria, nor does it automatically mean that new conditions, such as long COVID, would be considered industrial disease. Instead, this bill largely replicates the functions of the IIAC in Scotland, which the committee has heard extensive criticism of. It is also important to note that many areas that stakeholders would like to see reformed in relation to this benefit, such as occupational health and safety and employment law, are reserved to the UK Government. It therefore makes more sense to wait until we have a clearer understanding of the level and form of advice, expertise and scrutiny required before legislating to introduce an advisory body. That is why we've committed to explore these issues through a public consultation. We've also committed to establishing a stakeholder advisory group to take forward the recommendations that emerge from our consultation. While I do not want to preempt the outcomes of the consultation, the group would be able to take forward the kinds of questions raised in response to Mr Griffin's bill. For example, the group could consider questions around long COVID and the gender disparity in the current scheme. The group could consider also the current provision of scrutiny and advice in the context of the existing UK Industrial Injuries Advisory Council and the Scottish Commission on Social Security. Our position is therefore that the question of whether to establish a statutory Scottish Advisory Council is best considered as part of our wider work on industrial injuries, alongside the range of questions stakeholders and recipients of these benefits expect us to consider. And for those reasons I have set out, Convener, the Scottish Government will not be supporting this bill, but I do look forward to any questions the committee has on this issue.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I think you've been very clear that the Government doesn't support this bill, but can I ask whether the government is open-minded to elements within the bill? Because not supporting the bill is one thing, open-minded to certain aspects of the contents of the bill is another thing. So are those being ruled out, or will those be considered in the round as part of a wider government consultation?
Well, I think, as I tried to lay out in my opening remarks, many of the issues which have been raised by stakeholders, and indeed many of the issues that have been raised by Mr Griffin directly, it will need to be looked at by necessity as we carry out that wider consultation on industrial injuries. And that's why it's important that we do look at these things in the round rather than one part. I would compare it, perhaps, Convener, to the fact that we're being asked by this bill to design a part of the jigsaw when you don't actually know what the whole jigsaw is looking like and what jigsaw you're actually trying to build. And that's the challenge that we have. So there are a number of very pertinent issues that have been raised. I don't think there's any issues with any of that being raised as part of the consultation. I would expect that very much to come up during our consultation process.
Okay, thank you. I mean, it's clear the Scottish Government is going to have to think very carefully about the kinds of knowledge and expertise that will be necessary to advise ministers on social security for industrial disease and injury. Can you give us a little bit more information on the kind of knowledge and expertise you think will be vital?
Well, we will need to have great knowledge and expertise, and that's why we would want to hear from a range of people, whether that's scientists, occupational health professionals, trade unions, and very importantly, of course, those who are already on the current scheme. That's been a defining way that we have always developed our social security system here in Scotland. With regards to any future advisory council, the expertise and knowledge required will depend on the shape of the employment injury assistance and what that shape that will be. So far, if I can give one example, Convener, the current membership of the IIAC reflects the medicalised eligibility criteria for IIDB. Now, you heard in your evidence sessions many criticisms of this criteria and how the IIAC operate. If employment injury assistance was to depart from IIDB at any point in the future, the kind of knowledge and expertise required could be very different. So again, I go back to the fact it's very difficult to know exactly the type of knowledge you would want to have on any council in the future until its role and remit is decided. And that's why the membership should be decided when we know the role and the remit, and that very much depends on the shape of the benefit.
I do want to go and ask about the worker voice and the voice of lived experience and occupational health in a moment. But in relation to the first couple of answers, Cabinet Secretary, I take it we can infer from that SCOS would not be an appropriate vehicle to offer that advice, or if it was to be SCOS, there would have to be fundamental changes to the structures of SCOS to be able to do so.
Yes, SCOS was, as the committee knows, well versed by meeting SCOS in the past, they have a specific remit that they've been set up for. Of course, if we were to ask them to undertake anything different to that, that would require a change of remit and a change of expertise. But again, I would hasten to say that at this point, we don't know whether we would be suggesting a different type of council or a change to SCOS until we know the remit. And I would refer the committee to Dr Simpson's evidence in the session about whether, for example, SCOS could have a subcommittee on this That is but one area that could be taken forward. There are many other ways, but again, that very much depends on the type of benefit, and you would then roll on to what the council would be, where the membership would be, and where that would best sit.
I think one of the things the committee became very aware of, particularly a couple of weeks ago, we were listening to Lucy Kenyon, who is from the Institute of Occupational Health, and from Professor MacDonald, who was speaking about the need to collect better and more robust data within the workplace in relation to emerging trends and issues with regarding industrial injury and illnesses. There's a gap there. Trade unions are clearly keen to be part of the partnership that plugs that gap and gets that data. So is occupational health. I have to say, I think there's a role for the Health and Safety Executive. Well, unfortunately, they're not giving oral evidence to our committee, but I think they've got a role to play. Could you maybe say a little bit more, Cabinet Secretary, about which organisations and bodies you think have got a significant role to play? And, well, first of all, do you accept there could be a gap? And which bodies, individuals and groups do you think could help plug that gap in terms of data and emerging trends in relation to such illnesses?
Well, I think there was a number of interesting points raised by stakeholders in the evidence sessions around this. And it's very important that we do look to see where there are concerns in this area. I would point to, again, one of the complicating factors being, of course, that much of what has been talked about is reserved. Health and safety at work is reserved, and that does create a number of challenges. So the IIAC has an observer from the Health and Safety Executive at every meeting. Occupational health and safety is not devolved to the Scottish Government, so it would be difficult to replicate this prevention role, raising a question about how a Scottish body would engage on the important subject of prevention. So there is definitely a discussion that needs to be had. It's a complicated discussion just due to the devolved reserved settlement, and it's an issue I'm very keen to explore in depth. And again, and I will keep coming back to this, convener, that's why important we look at this in the round, and we look at the wider challenges that we have around, for example, how to work with the Health and Safety Executive and how to work with agencies that are reserved to make sure that it's fit for purpose. So I very much hear what was said on this. I hear the concerns from trade unions and others on this, but that's why it's important that we look at this with a broader lens than this bill allows us to do.
Cabsec, just before I pass on to Minnie McNair, which I'll do shortly, just for my clarity, and without getting into the wranglings between whether health and safety or occupational health should be devolved or reserved, irrespective of where those powers sit, do you believe there should be a clear role for the Health and Safety Executive, and there should be a clear role for occupational health, as, of course, our trade union movement?
Well, if you're talking about what would happen with our employment injury assistance, clearly the Health and Safety Executive is one example that we will need to look at. But I, with respect, convener, I won't suggest any solutions to that while we are still yet to carry out the consultation on the bill. But I very much do hear what you're saying about the suggested gaps that are there and the fact that we will need to work together. And that's despite these being reserved, because regardless of where the powers lie, we will need to work together, as we have done with the DWP and the devolution of powers.
Okay, thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Move to Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and your officials. Our committee is keen to ensure that the aspirations of all witnesses are actually delivered on as best we can in the proposed bill. On assessment, do you believe that the bill meets those aspirations?
I think, having read and seen some of the witnesses, my concern, having listened to it, is many of their concerns will not be answered by this bill. They have raised specific, quite rightly, concerns about the current council and the current benefit. They will not be, in my mind, resolved by the setting up of another council which sits alongside the current council, because much of what has been discussed is around the eligibility criteria which do not change, and how an individual is assessed, which does not change. Nor does this bill change the medicalised nature of disability, as it's defined within this piece of legislation. So my worry is that people think this bill will solve issues, and it will not. They have rightly raised concerns that do need to be addressed, but they will not be addressed by the setting up of a council, which in effect will not be able to make any changes, and nor will Scottish ministers be able to act upon the suggestions that this council, if it was put into being, would actually make to us.
Thank you. With other transfers, there's been minor adjustments to eligibility criteria. And is it possible a transfer we could include widely accepted asbestos-related cancers, for example, or a safe and secure transfer where we're going?
So I think we need to be very careful about when we're talking about specific conditions or specific disabilities, because again, I have a concern as we've watched this process of specific conditions being brought up, particularly with the greater suspect and not members of this committee, when it's brought up by a politician of get this council set up and it will be able to do something on this condition, which is important. Politicians should not be determining the conditions that are part of a scheme. Our role is to set up the eligibility, to set up the process, and then to leave it to experts and advisers to advise on what the changes should be. So again, I would urge caution on those who think that this is the solution to a specific injury or a specific condition being able to be part of a scheme. When it comes to what changes can be made, the committee will have heard me and my predecessors always talk about safe and secure transition. And that's important because our first responsibility is for those that are already on the benefit. If we're looking to make changes, for example, to eligibility, you run the risk of having a two-tiered system. We've had this discussion for every single benefit that's been devolved. That is inherently unfair. It's also inherently problematic legally, because you would have one set of people being referred to by certain rules and you would have another group of people being referred to by other rules. That is legally problematic, if I can put it that way. And therefore, the ability for us to make changes while case transfer continues is very challenging. And I think that's one of the other aspects that we need to look at. And it is really important to always reflect upon our responsibility for those that are on the benefit and our responsibility not to set up a two-tiered system with the legal challenges that will present. So, yes, theoretically, some changes could be made. You are at that point very much talking about around the edges to allow those legal problems not to happen. And at that point, you're tinkering around the edges of a scheme which many of your stakeholders have said is inherently and systemically unfair, and therefore will not again deal with some of the challenges, many of the challenges and problems that they've raised during their evidence.
Thanks for that. Is the Scottish Government still planning to re-establish a stakeholder advisory group on industrial injuries, as mentioned in your letter to the committee?
Yes, we do. I think that's very, very important because, I think there's been suggestions that part of the role of this council that would be set up through this bill would be to advise on how a new benefit might look in the future. With the great respect, we don't need to have primary legislation and a council established to do that. We have, for every other benefit we've had very successful stakeholder groups that have been established that would be able to take forward points in the consultation. I'm presuming certainly that the people that have been suggested as those that would be on the membership of those council would be exactly the type of people that would be on this stakeholder group, but there would also importantly be others as well. So we could have that stakeholder group in place That will provide a way for experts and people with experience of the current system to feed into policy development, as we have done previously. Now, of course, that then does that role until the new benefit is in place. And then, of course, we would move on to permanent bodies, as I've said before, the role and scope of which would be determined by what the actual benefit would look like itself. So you don't need a council to be in place to do that. Their stakeholder groups can do that for us.
Thanks. I previously asked for assurances that Clydebank Asbestos Group would be included in that advisory group, and hopefully that will continue. Just for one final question. In your consultation on employment injury assistance, do you envisage the core principles of the Mr Griffin's bill to be covered in that?
Well, obviously, people can reply to absolutely anything they want during the consultation process, but I have met with Mr Griffin in the past to discuss this bill, and I thank him very much for that. The conversations we've had, I appreciate he has found it frustrating that the government does not support his bill, but I've certainly valued the time that we've spent discussing this. I think what this bill process to date has done is raise many of the issues which will greatly assist with the wider consultation when it does take place. He has gathered an exceptionally strong amount of evidence and stakeholder engagement, which would certainly be very welcome for us allow us to have that in mind as we shape our way forward. So the stakeholders who do support the bill, I hope, although they may be disappointed the government is not supporting Mr Griffin's bill, we have heard what they've said, and that is something absolutely, the challenges that they brought forward will absolutely be taken forward in the wider consultation that we would do in the future.
Thanks, Mary. Thanks for your responses.
Okay, thank you, Marie. Katie Clark.
Yes. Does the Cabinet Secretary not accept that setting up a council now to do the work to inform the policy approach will mean that any changes are ready for implementation sooner? And she's spoken about a stakeholder advisory group, so does she see that body as performing the same function in light of what she's just said to Mary McNair? I think she accepts that the current scheme is not fit for purpose. She called it inherently unfair. And I'm told that only 7% of current people who receive the benefit are women. Now, whether that's the exact right figure or not, I'm not sure, because it was quite difficult to get that information. But it's quite clear that the vast majority of people that receive the benefits are men, and that doesn't reflect where injuries lie. So if she accepts that the current scheme isn't fit for purpose, doesn't she also accept that we really need to start the work to frame out what a new benefit might look like as soon as possible if we're going to get to a position where we've got a satisfactory benefit? Because yet again, she is going to be, if you like, responsible for a benefit that isn't fit for purpose in the same way that we've seen with other social security benefits.
So I'm not sure by that final reference you're saying that we've got benefits that aren't fit for purpose at the moment.
Perhaps it's not helpful to get into the current benefits. I mean, right. To a large extent, you've simply mirrored what's happening down south, which many of us hoped would not be the position that we'd be doing something better. But let's not get into that discussion, because let's just focus on the injury benefit in the sense of whether it's fit for purpose.
I'm not referee. If the Cabinet Secretary wants to give a very brief response to that, because Katie Clark did mention it, but brief Cabinet Secretary, because there was a substantive question behind that.
I will be brief, because we've got an important thing, but I'm afraid that was an unfortunate dig on a system which the client surveys for Social Security Scotland show in evidence that people have seen an inherent difference to and actually feel that they have dignity, fairness and respect. So perhaps for another day, convener, I would more than welcome the opportunity to rebut that more fully. But on the substantive point that we have, as I've said previously, have had the opportunity to lay out why I think a stakeholder group can take on the type of role that has been suggested for this council until a benefit goes live. We don't need a council. We haven't needed a group set up to be able to advise us in this type of way for any other benefit. So I think we have proven by the work that we've done on other benefits that we work well with stakeholders, we work well with those with lived experience to be able to design a benefit and can do that. And it's important that that's done at the right part of the process because, again, it's you need to do the policy development before you then look at what the actual system might look like and start building the system. So clearly our experience, I think, has shown how you can devolve benefits and transfer cases and also make up new benefits only available in Scotland with stakeholder engagement. And I would certainly be very confident that those that have been involved in DAC PIAG, for example, and others have felt those have been exceptionally worthwhile committees that have really shaped the benefits that they've taken part of. In terms of the aspect around women, this is one of the areas that really strikes me as an area where certainly it would appear that this benefit has inherent flaws in the way that it's set up because it is very much based on a system that was set up for traditional heavy industries that were obviously mostly male in nature, and the scope of the benefit has not changed. Again, I go back to the fact if that is something which is a concern, none of that changes if this council is set up, because the eligibility stays the same. It's the eligibility that's perhaps the problem that has led to the lack of women being able to come forward, not the fact that we need another council to do more research on other areas. So there is an issue around women. There is an issue around the medicalisation of this rather than a social description of disability. So there are systemic issues with this which we will need to look at in this benefit. None of that will be solved or changed if this council is put in place.
But surely the point is that the council would be doing work to inform decisions round about eligibility. Is that not something that would add to the policy process?
The stakeholders, for every other benefit, we've had stakeholder working groups. DAC PIAG's the most obvious example, but there have been others where they have shaped the eligibility and the policy development. So as we've went through a process for every other benefit, we have had stakeholders, experts, advisers in place that have been able to shape the eligibility, take part in that policy development with us. We have not had to pass primary legislation to set something up which we then don't know whether it would actually be of use in its current format when we've eventually set the benefit up to help us with shaping eligibility. There are other and more simpler ways of doing that that don't require legislation, and we've done that in the past.
Surely the lesson we've learned from previous experience is if we don't start the work soon and as quickly as possible, it means that we do end up taking on the schemes that already exist for extended periods of time. And surely this is an opportunity, whether it's an advisory group or whether it's a council, whatever you call it, a body that would do the work to inform that policy approach is something surely, Minister, we should be trying to implement as soon as possible. What is her timeline?
So the timeline for this benefit has changed as we've set out in the past, because we moved to include Scottish Child Payment into our work. So the public announcements were made around the changes to timeframes to allow us to do the work on the Scottish Child Payment. That was the big change to the timetable that was included in this work. I am very keen to move forward with the consultation process early in the new year to seek views on how we'll move forward with this. What then infers from the timescale for that very much depends on what comes from the consultation. So do people wish us to move forward with the, in essence, a similar type of benefit than we have just now? That is a different timescale than it would be if people are looking for a completely and utterly different benefit. For example, moving away from medicalised to social definitions of mobility. So the time frame with respect does depend on what people want us to do when the consultation comes out, but whether that's minor changes or large changes.
But on the basis that the, let's presume the consultation is saying that the work needs to be done to inform a new benefit, what would the Cabinet Secretary's timescale be on her stakeholder advisory group? What is that time frame? How quickly will this work start? That's the question I'm asking.
Well, we expect the consultation to come out early in the new year, and I would expect the work on the stakeholder group to also begin within that scope. Now, I would want to consult people on who would be in that, not through the public consultation, but I would want to take advice, and obviously if the committee has views on who would be on that stakeholder group, I would very much welcome that. But I don't see any reason for that stakeholder group to have to wait until that public consultation is over. So that can begin to be worked on early in the new year as well, when we move forward with the public consultation.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you for that exchange, and remiss myself not to say I think we were going to have some other questions on the timescale coming up later, but those have been preempted.
And I
should have identified that as convener, but we are where we are, just put that on the record. So we now move to questions from our colleague Paul O'Kane, who's online. Perhaps.
Thank you. Thank you, convener. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, we can hear you.
Great. Yeah, I mean, I think just continuing along the lines of where Katie Clark left off in some ways, you know, this committee has heard significant criticisms of IIDB. For example, Ian Tasker told committee that it's no longer fit for purpose. So given those criticisms, you know, is it still an option to introduce EIA largely unreformed? You know, would the Cabinet Secretary recognise those criticisms and does she view it as acceptable to bring it in its current state?
So I think people will have their views during the consultation process about what the short-term measures might be and what longer-term changes might be. And I've already made the points about the importance of safe and secure transition for case transfer. A lot of the discussions that Ian Tasker, for example, brought up were around suggestions around changes to eligibility and the fact that those could be taken forward at the same time as case transfer. I've already pointed to the challenges that that would bring, given the potential introduction of a two-tier system during that. But I do absolutely hear loud and clear the criticisms of the current system, and I'm very sympathetic to those that would like to see changes through the new benefit when it's fully devolved and administered by Social Security Scotland. We would have to be realistic about the timescale that some of that may need. And I will always go back to the fact that if people are wanting us to make large-scale systemic changes to the actual essence of this benefit, that will take longer than keeping the core of the current benefit and making changes around the edges. But I very much do take the point that there are problems with this benefit, inherent problems with this benefit that will need looked at. They might not all be delivered overnight, but there are changes that we can make, as we've done with other benefits, on a journey to where people might get to. But again, I'm open to that in the consultation to see what that would look like for people and how they would want, how much time they would want us to take to make very, very large changes, maybe longer than some people would like. But if they're wanting to see big changes, then that will obviously take longer to develop the policy for.
Thank you, Convener. I mean, I think it's interesting the Cabinet Secretary talking about timescales and the length of time it's going to take to do things in this space. The Scottish Government's made repeated commitments to bring forward this consultation. It's been continually delayed. Committee was told in September it would be this year. You know, the last month of the year starts tomorrow. So, you know, where is the Scottish Government in terms of the process of formulating that consultation? And why have there been such repeated delays? You know, what has actually stopped the Government from providing clear timelines on this?
So, as I think I mentioned already, Convener, one of the aspects around timeline was very much initially because we put the Scottish Child Payment into the Social Security programme. And that was an announcement I think I made in my previous role around this. I have taken the time since the reshuffle and coming back into post to look at this very carefully. There are inherent challenges in this benefit which are completely different to any other benefit that we've ever had. And that has made me look at this again, just to check where we're at with it. I can't stress enough the challenges of moving a benefit which is in a number of warehouses. I don't even think we know how many warehouses the Scottish cases are in, but they're in paper-based format in a number of warehouses, not sitting in an easy transferable way and absolutely not digitalised. So there are challenges to this, and therefore there are costs to how we might want to do that. And whether we need to look at different ways of doing this, because this is a very, very different system. So we're absolutely committed to taking this process forward, but it has got different challenges to it than any other benefit we've had. And they are expensive challenges, given the fact that this is a non-digitised benefit.
I mean, Convener, the Cabinet Secretary has made that point a number of times. I think the issue here is this consultation, the pledge on a consultation is now 3 years old. So can the Cabinet Secretary give any sense of timescale? I mean, as I said, the last month of the year is going to start tomorrow. Clearly, you're not going to deliver a consultation this year. So is there any indication of when that's going to happen?
So I think I've already said to other members that I would expect that early in the new year, with great respect again to Mr O'Kane, as well as the announcement on Scottish Child Payment. Clearly the work within Social Security has been impacted by COVID. So when he talks about what's happened in the past 3 years, please bear that in mind as well when we look at the what's been happening within Social Security, during which time, of course, Convener, we have continued to see the successful implementation and go live of a number of the most complex benefits that we have had in disability. But this one, yes, we do need to move forward to. The fact that I am taking time to look at this since I've came into post is because I recognise that there are challenges within this benefit that we do need to look at, and that they will not necessarily be resolved in a simple fashion, and that there are inherent problems to that we will need to look at in great detail.
Finally, Convener, yes. You know, the Scottish Fiscal Commission has forecast the spending on IADB is going to be £84 million this year, falling to £81 million in 2027-28. So would the Cabinet Secretary recognise that, you know, as there's a budget saving in that, that's because people are dying, essentially? So people are dying and not being able to make a claim. I mean, would she recognise that that is, you know, a serious issue?
Well, the Scottish Fiscal Commission makes its forecasts based on the current eligibility of the current scheme, and that's how they bring their forecasts forward, as they do with any benefit. Obviously, the Scottish Fiscal Commission can't take into account any potential changes that could be made to eligibility until the Scottish Government has designed that benefit.
Mr. Keane, I know Mr. Mason wants to explore the finances underpinning some of this. We'll come to you in a moment, John. Can I just check something, Cabinet Secretary? You keep talking about if eligibility criteria doesn't change, then outcomes won't change in terms of who qualifies and receives, whether it's the existing benefit or the new Scottish benefit. We heard a lot about this is based on expert opinion and the reasonableness test within that eligibility criteria. We also heard that I think the IAC currently have identified four conditions relating to long COVID that could potentially allow people to be in receipt of benefit, and that's caught up within the process there. I suppose the reason I'm putting that on the record is, what is it about the eligibility criteria that you think may need to change and may need to be looked at again? Because it's quite difficult when politicians and processes rely on experts to make recommendations, and then those recommendations aren't always accepted, in this case potentially by DWP on behalf of the UK Government. So what is it we may have to look at again in terms of that eligibility criteria and whether it should always be expert-led?
Well, I think it is very important that these aspects are expert-led, both in the design of the policy, but then once the policy is in place, how that's implemented. I would point to some of the evidence that was given previously. I think it was by Richie Allen, but forgive me, it may have been someone else, when they talked about the fact that the current scheme doesn't fit with the Social Security Charter, and there was a real desire, from my reading certainly, of that evidence, for not to copy something which embeds inequality and discrimination. And I think that was an important aspect that was brought up. And some of the aspects that I've mentioned already around the eligibility that is challenging is around the medicalisation, the medicalised description of disability in this, which does not fit with how we do things in the rest of the devolved settlement on Social Security. And that's but one example of that. I am aware that the Industrial Injuries Advisory Council have done a great deal of work on long COVID. I understand the committee has heard evidence on that, the fact that COVID has taken up a lot of their time, and the fact that they have been looking at that and have made recommendations to the DWP. I do recognise that that has been there with the DWP for some time, and they have not made a decision on that. I have asked for an update from the DWP on when they expect to be able to make a decision on long COVID. But I think, again, I do hear the frustrations that people have had about when the current advisory council makes a report and hands it to the DWP, decisions are not made quickly, and that is a frustration. Again, I would point to the fact that there is nothing in this bill that would change that. So people's frustrations about the timelines on these and the decision making would not change if this bill was enacted.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We'll move to John Mason now.
Thanks very much, Convener. I think focusing a little bit on the financial side of things, there's clearly a financial memorandum, and we have asked previous witnesses about that. I just wonder, I mean, if the Council was to go ahead, and I accept that the Government is not keen for it to go ahead, but if it was to go ahead, do you think the figures in the financial memorandum are realistic?
Well, I think it makes a number of assumptions around what the Council would do and how it would operate. And again, I would go back to the fact about I don't know if they're realistic, because I don't know what the benefit will look like that they will be advising on. So all I can look at is what it suggests the council would do while it remains the DWP that is doing this benefit on behalf of the Scottish Government through the agency agreement. And in that case, we would have a council that may or may not undertake its own research or may commission research that would give that their conclusions to Scottish ministers, and the DWP don't have to act on them. So again, I would query the value for money for that. The issue has also been raised in concerns about duplication as well, around whether any council set up would be duplicating the work of what's already happening within the current advisory council as well. And clearly that would be a concern. And the committee's also heard from a number of stakeholders that the proposed research budget is insufficient to make a meaningful impact. So if there's a query about the amount that the council would get in terms of its research to be able to carry out good research, that's one point. I would also question, even if it did carry out that research and came to conclusions, the DWP is in no way obligated to act upon them. So there are some concerns around that.
Okay, so that raises quite a lot of points, one being research, which you've mentioned. And I mean, I understand at the UK level is only £100,000 for research, which seems incredibly low. And this bill proposes £30,000. Do you get a lot of research for £30,000, as far as you know?
Well, no, you don't. Mr. Mason, you don't. I mean, I think part of the challenge with the set-up currently, and again, a committee has heard from this, is there's an expectation that a lot of the research or work is done on a voluntary capacity within the current council, which again would not seem, without to preempt any consultations that the government would take forward on this, would not seem a sensible or professional way to move about making that expectation on people to do that as part of a voluntary work. Now, the Advisory Council do carry out a tremendous amount of research on that work, but no, in essence, you don't get much for that money at all. So I would query whether that is a sufficient number, and if that is the number that was given to the council, what in essence the government or anybody else would be able to really genuinely get out of that process.
I mean, another cost that's mentioned is the IT and setup and so on. And I think we all know that IT costs sometimes run out of control. I mean, they're suggesting a setup for IT of £50,000 and maintenance costs annually of only £7,000. Again, that seems quite low to me.
Well, I would point out, Mr. Mason, that although that may be the case in other areas, costs have not run out of control in IT and Social Security Scotland. So just to make sure we put that on the record, but I take that as a concern around public agencies and large IT systems. Again, it is difficult to be able to assess that when we don't know what the benefit is. In fact, I would say it was impossible, because we don't know what the benefit is that we're actually trying to fit this into. So I would not be able to say whether one way or the other these are relevant costs or not, because this is, as I say, one part of a jigsaw that is yet to be designed.
OK, and you've made the point already that, you know, even if a council was set up and recommended expansion of who could receive benefits, that wouldn't necessarily happen for a variety of reasons. I mean, one of these being cost. I mean, say the council was set up and recommended, expansion, more women to get benefits, people with other injuries or diseases, perhaps stress. The fire service has been looking for cancer-related issues. Teachers, I think, with stress, different things like that. I mean, where would the budget come from? I mean, it's clearly not in this bill, but I mean, the £84 million or £81 million that's been mentioned already, I mean, if that was to double, is that financially feasible?
So, obviously, again, I would stress that none of the changes that have been suggested would come from this bill, because the DWP is not obligated to act upon any changes. But if changes were to be made to include a greater number, then obviously the bill would go up from the Scottish Fiscal Commission's forecasts, and that would have to come out of our block grant, the Scottish Government block grant, because we are making additional asks of the social security system that are not covered by the DWP, and therefore we would have to find that out of our relatively fixed budget, as is the way when we have made changes for every other benefit, which is, when you total it all up, a large amount of money. It is the right thing to do to make sure that we're delivering the type of social security system that we want in Scotland. But as always with these asks, I do, yes, point out to committee that they come with a financial cost that needs to be found from the Scottish Block Grant.
OK. Now, I'm also on the Finance Committee, so I don't want to overlap too much, but the Finance Committee is concerned about the kind of number of organisations in Scotland. We're a small country, and yet we're getting more commissioners, more councils, more commissions, call them what we want. Am I right in saying that the government, there is an assumption in government that we shouldn't set up new bodies except as a last resort?
Yes, and I think there is absolutely a case-by-case basis for us to look at these aspects. So if you're delivering something new, can it be done within a current body? So changing the remit of a current body, I think we mentioned some example was given about changing the remit of SCOS, but making it a subcommittee, and because we would very much have to change SCOS because it's set up for an entirely different structure and does not have the expertise on it to deal with these matters at the moment. But that is one example where you could perhaps look at a current body rather than setting up a different body, because, as you quite rightly point out, Mr Mason, there are costs inherent in setting up new bodies that we do need to take account of. And if we can simplify that process or use agencies, bodies that are already in place, we should certainly look to do that in the first instance.
So without preempting the consultation that's coming up, as far as you're concerned, it could be an option that all of these functions, the advice, the research and so on, could be fitted into an existing body rather than setting up a new one?
We would certainly want to ask whether people think it requires a different body or whether a current body could be adapted. But again, what that council would look like and where that might sit entirely depends on what we actually want that council to advise the government on, and it may be a very different benefit that we're looking at.
Okay, thanks, Camille.
Thank you, Mr Mason. Can I just ask maybe one final question that's in relation to, I suppose it's financial, but it's not directly related to this bill. But I suppose it's the financial exposure of demand-led budgets within social security that the new Scottish benefit will be subject to as well. You mentioned, Cabinet Secretary, that your officials were in contact with IAC and DWP about the long COVID aspects of the current benefit. Does that include like financial modelling work for what the exposure would be to the Scottish Government financially over any agency agreement if the DWP was to accept those? And so that's the kind of first part of the question. But what, if you like, horizon scanning work is the Scottish Government currently doing? You can send me in writing if you want, Cabinet Secretary, in relation to where you anticipate, without prejudging what any new eligibility may look like, what you anticipate the financial exposure would be to the Scottish Government going forward, because I'm minded that if Scotland does the right thing, as we absolutely should do, Cabinet Secretary, and the UK doesn't change anything, that will increase financial pressures on a Scottish budget. So it's not directly connected to the financial memorandum of this bill, but there's most definitely a correlation between what the aspirations of this bill are and the financial exposure of the Scottish budget and the Scottish Government. Is there anything more you can say about that?
Well, clearly when it comes to demand-led budgeting within social security, that is a, a challenge for us. With respect to, for example, long COVID, if the DWP were to make that change, then they would be making that change for part of their system, and therefore we would receive block grant adjustments for that. So I am not concerned about any changes that the DWP make to increase, because that would be part of the understanding that they have increased their levels of eligibility and cases, and therefore we would expect the same, and in effect that the impact should be reasonably neutral. The difference comes when we make changes up here that are not included down south, and that inevitably puts major pressures on our budget. I would be happy to provide a committee with the current update on just how much above the block grant we provide to Social Security because of the changes that we have made to the current devolved benefits and the new ones that we've brought in. And in terms of the horizon scanning, convener, in essence, we haven't gone into that in great depth, because that would very much depend on what the benefit would look like. So it could be quite a large number. It depends really what comes out of that consultation. And obviously the financial implications will be something that we would stress, as we always do in consultations, that when people are looking to things, it does come with a cost that needs to be found out of the Scottish Block Grant.
Okay, thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I don't think there are, it's always a dangerous thing for a convener to say, I don't think there are any other questions from colleagues. No one's catching my eye, mind you, I'm not looking at them. We will end this evidence session. So can I thank you, Cabinet Secretary, supported by your two officials. We appreciate your attendance this morning. And we'll just suspend briefly whilst we change panels for our next session. Thank you. Okay, welcome back, everyone. And we now move to agenda item three. Our next item of business is an evidence session with Dr. Sally Witcher, the former chair of the Scottish Commission on Social Security, commonly known as SCOS. The purpose of this session is to gain further insight into what lessons can be learned for the Scottish Social Security system going forward. So can I warmly welcome Dr. Witcher to the meeting and for accepting our invitation, but for all the work and effort you've put into designing and supporting Scotland's social security system up until this point in time as well. Can we put our thanks on the record to you? And we understand you have an opening statement before we move to questions, Dr. Witcher.
I do. Thank you very much. May I start by thanking the committee clerks and convener for their action to mitigate the risk for me as one of many people who remain at high risk from COVID, thereby enabling me to be with you today in person. I'm delighted to have the opportunity to talk to you about my reflections on my former role as Chair of SCOS in the context of a career spanning 30 years in which social security has been a recurrent theme. My learning concerns the strengths, weaknesses and such like arising through the innovative development of Scottish social security, as discussed in my article for the Journal of Social Security Law. Key to this are the constraints arising from the many interdependencies between reserved and devolved benefits. I was truly sorry to resign from my role as SCOS chair last year. My commitment to the goals for devolved social security and to the important role of SCOS were undiminished, and recognising that there has been much valuable innovation, my assessment of what Scottish Government can realistically achieve, though, has considerably reduced. I'd highlight the following points. The high-level architecture of the new system set out in the 2018 Act was remarkably coherent, anchored by a set of principles spanning all stages of the process, from policy development to delivery to continuous improvement. These were translated into practice by an enforceable charter, and people with lived experience had been integrated throughout the development and implementation of the system in highly innovative and valuable ways. But there are always going to be significant challenges to maintaining coherence and simplicity when translating policy into legislation delivery and impact in a turbulent, short-termist political environment, rapid churn of key players and changing end-user needs, often attributable to failures in other areas of policy, but also, of course, the COVID-19 pandemic. Much complexity is added by the multiple interdependencies shackling Scottish Government to a Westminster Government, pulling in a very different and, in my view, cruel and destructive ideological direction. Far from the complete autonomy over devolved benefits, which was anticipated and still, I fear, sometimes expected, devolved benefits serve as passport for reserved and vice versa. Scottish Government is tied to Westminster in terms of budget, whether Westminster accepts differently framed devolved benefits as passports for reserve benefits, the ongoing need for respective delivery systems to exchange information on eligibility. Westminster could pull the rug from under the devolved system whenever it chooses, and has shown clear signs that it well might. Meanwhile, if Westminster tightens eligibility for reserve benefit, that can have impact for access to devolved benefit, and Scottish Government cannot do anything that would increase Westminster expenditure without meeting that cost itself. That plays out into SCOS's scrutiny role, not just entailing ensuring new devolved regulations fit with the rest of the devolved system, but also with UK benefits too. It is a unique model as a body with potentially wider application, a way of inserting much needed expertise, continuity, and potentially has wider application. It means that knowledge is directly inserted into the legislative process in what is otherwise a very fluid environment. It will never be independently able to determine its own work plan, but must remain independent from government and parliament via this committee, but closely connected to both. SCOS is not just another stakeholder for this committee, and a strong relationship is helpful to both. I regret that due to secretariat challenges, we weren't able to give more time to the Social Security Charter, co-designed by people with lived experience. It has been a very effective tool in setting Social Security Scotland standards and culture from the bottom up. But it has been underutilised, in my view, and in some ways perhaps misunderstood. Clearly, since I left my role, there have been a lot of developments. The bill is obviously one of them, and it's great to see some sensible recommendations that address some of the governance issues that I had highlighted. There's also been challenges, as I suspected there might be, in the rollout of ADP. And we have the independent review of ADP pending, and other devolved areas of responsibility obviously still to roll out. All will be impacted by the sorts of challenges and constraints I've outlined. Yet there remain significant ways in which Scottish Government has made and still can make a positive difference to the lives of claimants, if not on the scale some of us would perhaps have wished. I welcome your questions with some trepidation, as I'm no longer on top of the detail in the way I was. I am not immersed in this area and thoroughly out of practice at appearing before committees. So with that caveat, I hand back to you, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Witcher. Very, very helpful opening remarks. I hope one of my colleagues will return later in the evidence session in relation to the financial challenges in the relationship between devolved and reserve benefits, but I won't take up those cudgels as an opening question. I'll be a bit more geekish about it, I think. And the predecessor committee to this one, when it was the Social Security Committee that I used to chair, one of the things we used to appreciate was reports by SCOS that made quite significant recommendations to government and how they can improve the rollout and delivery of a whole variety of matters. By and large, and I would say this, that seemed to work well. Those recommendations were robust, there was clarity, and government, not always, but by and large, seemed to respond positively and constructively to do that. Now, I'm a backbencher of government, Dr. Witcher, it suits me to say those things, but have I captured that accurately? Is that one of the things that have worked well? Is there more that needs to be done to support SCOS in doing that role going forward?
I think SCOS was always very concerned to ensure that the recommendations it made were realistic. And sometimes that led us to some unpalatable conclusions, but it was also important that we were kind of careful about wading too far into the policy terrain, decisions that were needed to be, rightfully, the matters for political judgment. Most of the recommendations were accepted, and I think it has most definitely shown its worth as a key cog within the social security environment. In my time, there were significant challenges, as I itemise in my article, around support and the nature of resources, very rapid churn of temporary staff in the Secretariat, which did hamper what we were able to do, and that was unfortunate. It wasn't necessarily through lack of effort on the part of officials. Scottish Government has, in civil service, has, much like DWP, from what I can remember when I was working there, incredibly cumbersome processes, and it's very hard to kind of make them work fast when you need them. Because of the way we were set up, there was a very difficult position I found as chair of a board that had very little in direct line, in fact, no direct sort of line responsibility for the Secretariat. We could not, I wasn't even allowed to be on the selection panel for the secretary. Effectively, it's like having a board of a body that couldn't be involved in recruiting the chief executive. Although the officials did their best to make sure I was involved where that was possible. And for the first recruitment I was, though I probably shouldn't have been. So that was really difficult because as a board of a separately constituted body, you have responsibilities, you have governance responsibilities, you're responsible for delivery. But we had no levers constitutionally to drive that. That was all within the gift of Scottish Government. And if they were, for whatever reason, unable to deliver, there was nothing that we could do about it. But I, as chair, felt responsible. That was not always a comfortable place to be. I was very pleased, therefore, when I made, shall we say, suggestions that some of these issues might usefully be addressed, that these were heeded, that a review has been carried out, has come up with largely very sensible recommendations, and the changes in the bill, from what I've seen, will go a very considerable way to addressing some of the governance issues. Meanwhile, the Secretariat has been much expanded with permanent staff. So my feeling is that SCOS should now be well equipped to carry its role forward. And that is going to be very important, because we achieved what we did despite the lack of support and in the face of difficulties, rather than with those driving us forward.
Dr. Richard, it's not often a witness comes to the committee, identifies the problems, and then the same response gives the solutions and says they've been delivered all in one. So thank you. Can I just ask one brief further question? I may come back in later, depending on time. But within the paper that we read ahead of today's committee, you were quite keen that expertise captured within SCOS was used proactively as well as reactively. So, other than scrutinising regulations and legislation and making recommendations for what should be tweaked and what should be changed and what should be altered and what could be clearer, all that kind of thing, I think you're talking about a much more proactive role in relation to, there's a pattern emerging here in relation to this area of devolved, or even the interaction devolved and reserved social security matters. A piece of research, a bit of proactive work in relation to that would be helpful, and that's something currently SCOS can't do because it's not able to do or is not resourced to do. But you mentioned that in your paper. Could you say a wee bitty about that, and then we'll move on to some colleagues to come in for some other questions.
I'm not entirely sure I've answered the question, so please stop me if I've not got the right end of the stick. I think it is a problem for the way governments are structured, the way they work, the way the civil service works, the way politics works, that there is very little continuity. People gain expertise, they go. Convener, you are a rare exception in coming back. But generally speaking, people gain expertise and they go away and somebody else comes in and they've got different ideas and so on. What is really lacking in a complex area like this is that kind of consolidation, that institutional memory, if you like, of expertise. That is what, and the strategic oversight, both sort of looking back and forward, but across at the same time. And that is what SCOS, I think, brings to the table. I do think that there could be scope for it to do more proactively. The Charter potentially opens the door for that with more resourcing that it now hopefully has, because it is able to proactively initiate reports on matters contained therein. But it isn't quite, in my view, as open as the equivalent powers for the Social Security Advisory Committee in Westminster, which can quite independently of anything just decide it wants to go and investigate something, and it can do that. The Charter is very explicitly focused on the role of Scottish Government and Social Security Scotland. But as I've outlined in the paper and just now, what they can or cannot do is very much impacted by DWP and other players. And so there's some challenges there about quite how, through the Charter, you're looking at that bigger picture of underlying factors, when the Commission has no direct relationships with, say, DWP officials, and I can't imagine that DWP officials would be terribly keen to have that relationship with us. So I don't know if that answers your question. Was that what you were seeking?
I think it does. I think the important thing was you laid out quite clearly what the limitations are, but what the opportunities are going forward, and you've kind of left it hanging there about that relationship with DWP officials. And that is something that, that absolutely does need to be developed. I wouldn't explore that further because there's a whole ream of colleagues wanting to come in to ask ask questions. I don't want to dominate. Jeremy Balfour.
Good morning, Tavina, and good morning, Sally. Sorry I'm not with you this morning in person, but thank you for the evidence you've given so far. Sally, you were around when we were putting through the original bill, and one of the questions we asked at the time was in regard to the charter and whether it should have some legal authority behind it. Now, the committee at that point and the government at that point said no. Is that something you think we should revisit? Does the charter need a legal basis so that people can challenge it in some way, or is it working as it is at the moment?
That's a really interesting question, and my one of the things I think is important about this charter is that it does have more teeth than most charters, which frankly are not worth the paper they're written on, in my humble opinion. But whether it is, and there are enforcement measures in there, via the Commission and also via reporting to the Parliament. This is one area where I think perhaps the Charter has been underutilised. It is potentially a vehicle through which, for example, this committee could be in asking questions and holding Social Security Scotland and the Scottish Government to account. That is something perhaps to consider. I have no, at the moment, fixed views on whether legal backing would be essential or add value. I think it does need to be made meaningful. And if the mechanisms in place, which frankly I don't feel have been fully tested yet, don't deliver that level of enforcement, the teeth as promised, then yes, I do think legal enforcement is definitely something that is worthy of consideration.
Ken?
I think you're on mute. You are on mute.
I was waiting to come off mute. Thank you for that. That's really helpful. If I can move on just to a couple of other quick areas. I think you've addressed this with the convener already, but obviously I think the timescales you were being asked to respond to consultation documents was a challenge. Again, I wonder if you could just outline how that works, and did you feel you had enough time to respond to particularly the ones on regulations that were very detailed?
Yeah, it very often was a challenge, yes, but then the legislative timetable was a challenge, and the intervention of the pandemic didn't help matters because a lot became sort of backlogged, and then the year after lockdowns, there was a huge amount of business coming our way. I think it's challenging to the extent that I'm trying to be realistic here. Yes, in an ideal world, SCOS would certainly have more time. Probably governments would have more time and committees would have more time. But we're not living in that world and we have to be realistic. Although it said in the Act that SCOS should be given the time it needed, the reality was that if there was a legislative timetable imperative for some regulations to be done by a certain point, that was going to happen whether we reported or not. And if we didn't, if we missed the boat, we could still report, but it would not have the impact that it would have done. So I think that is certainly the aim, that SCOS should be given as much time as it needs. Perhaps with better planning, there might be, I don't know, because I know officials tried, there are pressures as to why that became very hard. But trying to avoid conversions, the problem was not necessarily one set of regulations with that inadequate time. It was that you get a whole bundle coming together at once. So you're trying to deal with several, all with their own timelines. And that was where it became really, really challenging.
Thank you. That's also really helpful. My final question, Sally, is obviously you've mentioned we've got the new bill coming to committee. It's out for consultation at the moment. Yes. If you could make one change with your experience, what would you like to see in the bill that's not there at the moment?
Well, you are assuming that I've actually read...
Richard, can I just apologise to you, because I suspect there's more than one change you would like to see, but one... And I apologise for cutting across you.
I think that's... Well, you're kind of assuming, Mr Balfour, that I have read the bill in depth, scrutinised it, and actually know what's in it to some extent in order to form a considered judgment. I regret to tell you that isn't the case. I have some thoughts on what I've seen, but I am not in a position to go into that level of detail without, and I would, and I don't want to, because I, if I may, I do not feel that, you know, in a sense, the Scots's reputation and hopefully my own is that I'm not going to give you off-the-cuff answers to things that I don't feel equipped to answer. I'm happy to kind of go away and look at it and come back with an answer to your question, having given it due consideration, but I would prefer not to attempt to answer it here and now, if that's all right with you. Thank you.
That's absolutely fine. Thank you, Sabina.
Thank you, Dr. Witcher. Thank you, Jeremy. We'll move to Katie Clark now.
Thank you. And I have to say, I think this paper is really, really helpful in terms of reflections on your experiences. And you've spoken about the less than glorious track record from Westminster on social security benefits. And I think it's fair to say that many of us have quite high expectations of what might be possible in Scotland. And indeed, in your paper, you talk about those high expectations bumping against implicit and explicit constraints. So I suppose, as somebody maybe looking at outcomes, one of the surprises, despite what the Cabinet Secretary said earlier, is the frustrations and the experience of many claimants who don't actually feel that the experience in terms of the outcomes is that much different. They're still having to wait lengthy periods of time for benefits, and sometimes, you know, those benefits are not granted. So there's two categories, I suppose. There's creation of new benefits, things like the Scottish Child Payment, and then there's the migration of existing benefits. So in relation to the latter, what would you say are the lessons learnt about our experiences so far, about how we do that better so that we're not just mirroring what comes down, comes from down south, and how we maybe speed up the process to get to a better outcome? I know a lot of that's about money, but if we maybe put money to one side on the basis, the aspects that aren't about money.
Okay, let me just make sure, there's a lot in that question and I want to make sure I've understood it. So you're asking about expectations around both delivery and what is delivered?
I think I'm asking what you think the lessons that have been learnt over the last few years are, so that when we're looking at migration of benefits, we perhaps do it better in future, and there's a quicker process to get to an outcome that might be a better outcome.
Okay. I think that that's... I think the constraints I refer to in my paper have major roles to play in different respects. But there is another one, which is to do with the scale of the task, where it concerns setting up a new delivery system from scratch, as well as a new lot of benefits for it to deliver. The reality, and as I said, my career in social security spans... I was thinking, it goes back to 1989 was when I first entered this realm, and I remember when DLA was introduced. I remember the unmitigated shambles that ensued, and I remember the then chief executive of what was the Benefits Agency, a bit like Social Security Scotland set up, being hauled in front of committees and Newsnight and whatever, having to account for it. The reality of the matter is that setting up a new system takes time. There may well, and I think it's important that that time is taken. I do think safe and secure transition is the priority. In a way, it's impossible to have another one because of the agency agreements. You've got to do that first. If you then, whilst you're trying to transfer, also try and change what has been delivered, you're trying to run two processes at once. People transferring whilst also perhaps applying for the other benefit or a changed benefit, And that is immensely, immensely challenging, delivery-wise. And in a way, I suspect that a bit of that is what has happened with the ADP rollout, as well as the scale. Is relatively straightforward, well, much more straightforward, to deliver a high-quality, person-centred process at small scale. The reason why larger systems perhaps don't have that so well is because it takes more time and more resource. You can't kind of have your cake and eat it always. And some of the things, that the very good things that Social Security Scotland is trying to do will take more time, will maybe from a pure, you know, budget bottom line basis, maybe cost a bit more, but the outcomes ultimately will be better. So I think they've experienced some challenges. I would caution, I think one of my frustrations, and I understand the frustrations of politicians and recipients, I really do, because I also feel that. but I also, my practical brain, and what I know is that trying to go too fast is going to cause even more problems. That said, I am not into the kind of nuts and bolts of Social Security Scotland systems. I cannot say whether there are other ways to do it. I am aware they have put in place some changes to those systems, and they are starting to deliver some results. But I think you'll have to pick that up with them. So I don't know whether that answers your question.
Okay.
Does that help?
Yes, it's given a perspective, so that's very helpful. Thank you.
Okay,
thank you, Katie. Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Dr. Witcher. You mentioned in your blog how you accepted that doing away with the 20-metre rule was not possible at that point. Can you share with us any kind of further dilemmas about this issue? And we're going through that just now, obviously. We're looking, obviously, at the Employment Injury Assistance Support, and obviously it's remained unchanged since 1948. So if you could share your views, that'd be great.
Yes, I mean, at the time, I think the main challenge was around kind of what I've been talking about, trying to make a change to the actual benefit that was going to be delivered, whilst also transferring a load over. That was going to cause a lot of challenges, which could be quite, well, impossible, very hard work. So it is about how these constraints impact. Now, I've listed in my paper, my article, different types of constraints. So much of this is kind of tied to, and in a way, what this committee's role is, and SCOS's role is to try and tease out where there is realistic room for manoeuvre. And there often is, but you have to burrow quite deeply sometimes, which is why I think there have been some positive changes to things like ADP. But there are practical reasons sometimes. And for me, it's, and I suspect for you as well, it's where what you really passionately want to see hits up against practical realities of what can be done in the real world, and having to kind of come to terms with that. And that was my experience with that. We quizzed officials thoroughly. And also ministers, to try and find out whether, to try and find a way forward on that. And we had to conclude it couldn't be done now. Maybe in the future, but not now.
So that's me.
Yeah. Is that you, Marie?
Yep.
Oh. Short and sweet. John Mason.
Thanks very much. I mean, maybe a bit on the same theme. You talk about it's been a story of high expectations bumping up against implicit, consequently rendered explicit, constraints. And I was just wondering how much of the constraints are financial constraints. Is it, I mean, you've talked quite a lot about bureaucracy and process and all of that, but is one of the major constraints lack of finance?
It is one of them. But I think another very key one is the way in which, as I've said, reserved benefits give rise to eligibility for devolved ones, and vice versa. So thinking, for example, I mean, what I was looking at recently was the response, the government, UK government response on the work capability assessment consultation. And in that, there is a paragraph which makes very clear that this is an interim measure, but in due course, their aim is to basically use the PIP assessment. So the question I would have around that is, if PIP, for which ADP is the equivalent, is to become a route into or aligned with eligibility for a reserve benefit, as in universal credit type benefits, what does that mean for ADP if it were to be made more generous, and would DWP regard that as a passport to the reserve benefit? Because in effect, you'd have an inequitable system. If PIP was less generous and ADP was more, and both granted access to the same things within universal credit, for example, that becomes problematic. It becomes inequitable. And it's very, and would people have to go through a separate assessment to access effectively a PIP assessment on top of an ADP one? It's things like that. It's to do with whether DWP accepts more generous, in terms of criteria, benefits serving as passports for reserve benefit. And what happens if they don't? So that's, I think, a very key issue. I think the officials and SCOS always had to have an eye to, well, certainly officials, to whether what they were doing was going to be acceptable to DWP. Now, that wasn't at all, I think, what people understood when the system was set up. It wasn't my understanding, for sure. Maybe I was over-optimistic. But I do think that these sorts of constraints are very real. There are constraints, for example, if I think things like when the Scottish Child Payment was introduced, that relied on DWP providing information so that that could be extended. Now, if they didn't do that, the whole thing got held up. So there's a lot of different ways in which these things interconnect. Finance is certainly part of it. So if Westminster decides to cut eligibility in budgets, that is going to be through to Scotland. And as far as I'm aware, Scottish Government doesn't have a whole lot of money down the back of the sofa to play with. And again, we have to be realistic about that.
Yes. I mean, that's kind of emphasising quite a lot the relationship between Holyrood, including government and parliament and everything, and Westminster. So, and that's not something we can obviously control. So, I mean, I did notice that you yourself, you said you warmly welcomed and reciprocated the keenness of the chair of Westminster's SSAC to liaise regularly with SCOS. I don't know if that's still continuing now that you're not there, but that sounds positive. But I mean, do you think there's anything we can do to improve the relationship with DWP, or is it just going to be one of these things that fluctuates over time?
I think, it's very hard to say. I think you're right, it will fluctuate over time. It may even be contingent on personalities. I think, as you know, officials may work together well, but they're obviously answerable to ministers who will have different agendas. And I think there's a cultural divergence between the direction of travel for DWP ministers and the UK government and what the Scottish government was trying to do with a system based on fairness, dignity and respect. I think it's just something for this committee to be mindful of. For SCOS, in the early days, we had very good relations with the chair at SAC. The new chair seemed to be less keen to engage with us. There may have been entirely good reasons for that. I can't comment, and I have no idea what that is now. But that is a very important relationship, in my view. And it is an area where, if it works well, it can be immensely valuable, I think, to both their and our scrutiny. But my sense is that the DWP ministers, frankly, are not very interested in devolved social security. It is not uppermost in their minds, or even possibly in the back of their minds. And the ramifications of what they're doing for devolved social security, I suspect, is not something they're frightfully bothered about. I would like to be wrong. I look forward to being proven wrong on that.
Okay, that's also helpful. Another comment you make is, despite such constraints and policy changes, Scottish Government has thankfully been able to diverge a long way from Westminster. Is that more about how we do things rather than the actual content?
Generally speaking, it is. You have a lot of leeway in terms of how. And I didn't want that, you know, you should not underestimate the importance of that. The experience of people engaging with DWP processes is pretty horrendous a lot of the time. That certainly shouldn't be the case with Social Security Scotland, despite its recent difficulties. And the Charter is a way of trying to drive standards, and there is accountability around built into that, as we've discussed. In terms of what it delivers, it is more compromised, yes. It is much more constrained. And I think part of the skill in this role, and in the SCOS role, was this thing of trying to work out, it's ducking and diving, testing out little kind of routes, little possibilities, asking a lot of questions. Well, could we do it like this? Or why don't we do it like that? Or have you thought, why is it done like this? Challenging it has to be realistic, but also to challenge what realistic means in order to try and find scope for innovation. And I think the way the system was set up, the involvement of people with lived experience, because as I said in my article, if it doesn't work for the people on the sharp end, what's the point? What are we all doing? It is for them that this whole thing surely is supposed to benefit, and they are the ones that know whether it does. It's a very important perspective, and I think that is actually a very important feature of the devolved system, which is not present in the Westminster one, and I think it shows.
So, Convener.
Rose McCall.
Thank you, and hello, and thank you very much indeed for the information. I'm kind of mopping up a little bit here, so because I've got questions based on answers that have come back from other questions. A couple of questions to go to my colleague, Mr. Mason. You referred that some of the hope in the initial stages of setting up SCOS, or how it would or could be in the early days, really hadn't quite come to fruition. Given that there was those challenges, do you actually think that the devolved benefit system is as good as it could be, given that you've highlighted that it hasn't quite met maybe the aspiration that you first had?
Yes, I think in some ways, in many ways, I think what has been done on devolved social security has probably made very good use of the unexpectedly limited room for manoeuvre that Scottish Government in effect really has. With SCOS, yes, I think there was more we could certainly have done. However, at that stage, the Charter hadn't really kicked in as much as delivery was still small scale, and therefore the need for that challenge and oversight maybe wasn't there at that time in the way it will be and probably is now, given the scaling up and the increased complexity of different forms of provision being delivered and transfer as well. So I think the Charter is going to, it's up for review next year, and I think that's going to be incredibly important to hang on to the kind of ethos of it, and of it being driven from the perspective of the people using the system, and that it will come into its own and become an even more useful tool. So in a sense, SCOS did the essential work that it needed to do, and I think did it to a very high standard and demonstrably added value. It could have done more, but the bits that it didn't do, in a sense, is not irrevocable, and they maybe weren't the most important bits of the role at that time. They will become more important, I think, going forward.
Okay, that's very helpful. Thank you. And a lot of the information you provided today, and including your review that was sent to us, has been very helpful for me as somebody who doesn't have, is reasonably new to the committee and doesn't have that systemic memory that you were talking about before. Also, another question that sprung to mind, I think it was from the deputy convener, when you were stating earlier in this session that actually SCOS was now in a position where it could maybe handle an increased in responsibility as far as what we're looking to. The Cabinet Secretary earlier on was of the mind that it was maybe not the right way to go about this. So I was wondering if you could expand on your thoughts as to why you think it is maybe a right place to move forward, and whether SCOS is the right avenue to take on that additional responsibility.
Are you talking specifically here about industrial injuries?
Provision? I am, yes.
Right, okay. So I suppose what I'd say on that is SCOS currently, if part of the challenge is, I don't know what this benefit is going to be. And until we know what it is, we don't know what expertise we need in order to scrutinise it and make sure it's delivered as effectively as possible and designed as effectively as possible. But were it to be along the lines of the IIAB, then a whole different set of perspectives and skills and knowledge are going to be needed. Scientific, clinical, epidemiological, whatever that word is, and obviously from employers and trade unions, and I would say also, obviously, a lived experience. But that is assuming, and SCOS hasn't got that. It just doesn't. That's not what it's there to do. It's not what it was designed for. If you were going to extend that, you'd effectively just be... You'd still have to have, in effect, what would be all that you needed for a separate body, but sort of bundled in with what was already there. I'm not even sure it would be particularly helpful. Well, it wouldn't be helpful. It would merge and in a way that you'd still have quite distinct roles in there that don't necessarily completely overlap. That said, I do think, because SCOS has that more strategic oversight, and this is one of a number of different kinds of provision, one scenario might be that you have a structure where whatever new body is created, SCOS, and maybe the Scottish Fiscal Commission, as if you like the third angle on this, have some sort of structure through which they liaise to maintain that overarching oversight, because I think that's pretty valuable. But that's just a thought. It's not something I've considered in depth, but I can see a possible need for that. But I can tell you now that if something that was basically the Westminster equivalent were introduced in Scotland, SCOS, no, it couldn't do it. It's not the right body.
That's very informative. Thank you very much, and thank you for your candour. I appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you,
Roz. Can I just ask a couple of questions? I'd said at the start that if there was time, we'd come back in. I suppose it's about the relationship between devolved benefits and reserve benefits. I think sometimes the expectations on the Scottish Social Security system is a bit more kind of complex than we realise, because there's an expectation that it will mitigate the worst aspects of the UK system. So it could be the 455,000 households that get a council tax reduction in Scotland that don't get it elsewhere in the UK, or the £83 million that's been spent making sure households don't suffer the bedroom tax, and to mitigate where it can the benefits cap. So that's a direct spend on reserved issues, Dr. Witts, if you like, but also it has to be proactively progressive. And I'm thinking about the £450 million or whatever it is now on the Scottish Child Payment, which comes out of those funds as well. But you said something very interesting as well, Dr. Witcher, which was about almost like policy overspill. So where if we are more generous, is the wrong expression, I apologise, Dr. Witcher, if we have different rules for Scottish Disability Assistance, for example, and more people qualify and it's a passported benefit, then there's cost implications as well. And that could be chargeable back to the Scottish Government as a bill, effectively, under the fiscal framework as well. So as a committee, and I think as a nation, we don't always understand the financial underpinnings of that. So the concern I would have is it's difficult to see in the one place what the Scottish Government spends on mitigation of Westminster, what it spends on other areas new to Scotland, and what the cost implications would be of what is called policy overspill, effectively, that passporting impact. Do you have any reflections in relation to how, I mean, what I've said was a jumble of words that can sound quite complicated, but how we effectively boil that down to a kind of user-friendly, easy-to-understand analysis of the numbers in a consistent way every year? So we as a committee, SCOS and others can look at it and make an informed decision about what next of the Scottish Social Security system, because we are very ambitious, but we have to have the money to pay for it as well.
Okay, right. So a user-friendly way of doing that is what you're asking. Okay, let me think. Well, I suppose what I would say, I like very much the way you've sort of segmented the kind of expenditure on just like softening the worst impacts and the doing things differently and innovatively that are kind of like positive added value as opposed to just reducing the worst. I think that would be very interesting. That might be a kind of analysis for, say, I don't know, the Scottish Fiscal Commission to look at. It wouldn't necessarily be for SCOS. And I think it's fair to say, I didn't mention the Scottish Child Payment earlier. That is an example of where Scottish Government has gone beyond the just, you know, trying to make it less awful. It really has done something positive and different and useful there beyond that. But it is very constrained for a number of reasons. I noticed in the bill that there is a proposal to change the structure of that, so it's no longer a top-up benefit, if I've understood correctly. I may not have. I think that's right. I have it as a standalone one. I think that would be a really good idea, although it was done the way it was for very good reasons. But yes, I think there's... It's very... I think there's a job of work to be done here to really... communicate, have a grown-up conversation with people out there and in the Parliament about what is and isn't feasible and why. Yes, to challenge it, and I do think, you know, this is a committee that is there to ask the awkward questions, as indeed was SCOS. And there will be things that, creative ways forward, that maybe ministers and officials haven't thought of. But very often it is going to be the softening the worst impacts. That is not to be underestimated. It is very useful to do that. Every little helps. But it isn't necessarily, I suspect, what people envisaged when the Scottish Government received the devolved powers. It had higher expectations. And I don't think it serves stakeholders well for overly aspirational claims to be made about what's possible. I don't think it's useful to do that, or helpful, much as I understand that there may be political drivers for that.
That's helpful. I mean, just put on the record, I think the Cabinet Secretary in the last evidence session said she would go in and write to the committee and let us know what will be spent on mitigating UK benefits and what additionally spent. And I think it was the gap between block grant adjustments and Barnett consequentials and overall social security spend. And I look forward to that data. But it's making sure we collect that data in an independent, consistent, user-friendly way each and every year, to allow this committee to identify trends and to work out, as you said, what is possible to be done in the real world in relation to social security. But as we're drifting onto finance committee territory rather than social justice and social security. But that's very helpful. Are there any other questions from colleagues before I think, as I should do, allow Dr. Richard to make some final remarks if you wish to? Because as always with these lines of questions, there's something you want to say that we've taken you down off on a tangent, we've not been able to see it and make that clear, and I want to give you that opportunity. Do any colleagues have any questions before I give Dr. Richard the final word? No? OK. Dr. Richard, over to you.
Thank you. I'm not sure that I'm not sure I want to listen to the sound of my voice for very much longer, even if you're content to do that. I think I probably said what I need to say. If I may, if there are further reflections I have following this, I would like to write to the committee. If there's anything specific you would like me to advise on or give a view on, I'm open to do that, bearing in mind that I'm not working on a paid basis. I'm not here
I'm not earning any money being here. I'm doing it out of the goodness of my heart, but just so you know. But in theory, you know, I talked about accumulated knowledge. I think I may have some that is helpful or could be helpful, and I am very open to using that and putting it at the service of the committee and Scottish Government if that is going to be helpful. So please, if you would like to draw on that, I would say I'm very willing to assist.
Dr. Richards, that's very kind of you. I should reassure you, we're not looking for some unpaid consultancy work or unpaid expert advisory work. I think what we've all identified on a cross-party basis is you have got an absolute expertise combined with lived experience and a fiercely independent voice. And it's quite difficult finding individuals with all three rolled into one. So if we can keep some form of relationship going with the committee, I think the committee would very much appreciate that. So thank you very much for your time this morning, and we will keep that contact going. So that does end the formal part of this morning's committee, and we'll now move into private session. Thank you very much, Dr. Richards.